Here is another interesting example that I'm sure most of you would love. This is an example of a rear-wheel drive roadster, and we are trying to analyze its motion while it is rolling without slipping. So in this problem, we are given that there is a roadster, and it's accelerating from 0 to 60 miles per hour. We don't know in what duration. So it's going from V, so this is given. V is going from 0 to 60 miles per hour. And it has the load shown in the figure applied to each of the two rear wheels from the rear axle of the 2,570-pound car. So there is also another figure given, and that's basically showing some of the load supplied on each of the two rear wheels. So we have a torque, let's call it M0, that's given to you. You have a downward direction load from the axle, and there is a horizontal direction load going in the left direction given to you as well. So we'll call this V to indicate the vertical force and H for a horizontal force. Now remember, this is not a free body diagram, it's just showing some of the loads that are being applied on the rear wheels. So the first question that may spring to your mind is, where do these loads come from? So the moment M0 is of course the torque from the engine of the car, and the V and H are the forces that are transmitted to the wheel from the body of the car. Okay, so these three loads are given to you, and you're also given the weight of each wheel. So we're also given the mass or the weight of the wheel and a mass moment of inertia IG. So we also know the mass moment of inertia, and has a diameter of 24.3 inches as well as what its diameter is. Okay, and we have to find the normal and frictional forces between the wheel and the ground, the minimum coefficient of the static friction required for the wheel to roll without slip, and the time it takes for the car to reach 0 to 60 miles per hour. You have to assume that the car is accelerating uniformly while moving over a flat and level surface. Okay, so of course the first thing we have to do is draw the coordinate system. So let's say this is positive X, this is positive Y, and then we will do the kinematic analysis, and then we'll do the kinetic analysis using Newton-Island equation. So let's look at this problem before we get into writing the equations. So we have the power or the torque applied from the engine on each of the two rear wheels. We are also shown the two loads, and we're looking for its acceleration. So this is the supply side, right? You are given the supply side, and now you're looking for what kind of performance we can expect for this car to have. So what kind of acceleration it can have, what kind of angle acceleration its rear wheels would face, is the car going to slip or not? And that would depend on what are the friction forces acting on the wheels. If the friction forces exceed the maximum possible friction force available between the ground and the wheel, then we know the car is going to slip. So if you are actually going to design the engine, you are going to determine what kind of torque is needed, what kind of power is needed, you will have to do a complete analysis, dynamic analysis of the wheels as well as the car. Okay, so let's proceed along familiar lines. We'll start with the kinematic analysis. So again, the kinematic analysis goal is to determine the acceleration of center of mass. So we want to find acceleration of center of mass of the wheel as well as its angular acceleration, right? Those are the two things we're looking for. So let's see if we can determine either of them. One thing we know is that if the wheel is rolling without the slipping, then the acceleration of the center mass is related to the angular acceleration, and that is given as alpha times r, right? And that's the magnitude part. So if you assume that the car is moving towards right, then the wheel has to be rolling in a clockwise direction, and that means alpha would be a clockwise quantity, and that means ag actually along the x direction would be minus alpha r, right? We also know that the ag along y direction would be zero because the car is really not moving up and down. So we can write the acceleration of center of mass completely as minus alpha times r I hat, right? So this is good because we have reduced three unknowns to just one unknown. If we know alpha, then we know all the accelerations over here. Okay, now let's do the kinetic analysis. Kinetic analysis, which will start by drawing the free body diagram of the wheel. So we'll draw this again. Center of mass, external moment is given, V is given, H is given, What are the other forces? We have the normal reaction from the ground, and we have the force of friction, right? We need the force of friction, otherwise the car cannot roll without slipping. So given this free body diagram now, we can use Newton-Euler equation, sigma F equal to M times Ag, and this is X direction, this is Y direction, so we have minus H plus FF, those are the forces along X direction, plus N minus V, we also have the weight, minus Mg, J hat, equal to M Ag, which is nothing but M times minus alpha R, so this is minus alpha R I hat, right? So let's equate the X and Y components, we get minus H plus FF equal to minus M alpha R, and we get N minus V minus Mg equal to zero. So since V is given, Mg is given, we can compute N directly from this. So N is equal to V plus Mg. All right. From the first equation, we know only H. We don't know what friction force F is, and we don't know what alpha is, right? So there are two unknowns over there, so we can determine both of them. But we have one more equation that we can utilize, which is the moment equation. So sigma M about center of mass is Ig alpha. Sigma Mg would be, so the only moment we would have is the moment of friction force and this external moment, right? So the moment of FF would be positive, so that's plus FF times R, where R is the radius of this wheel, minus M0, which is given to us, equal to Ig alpha, right? Now notice how I'm not writing k hat anymore, because the sign is going to take care of positive and negative direction. Ig is given to us, okay? So we have another relationship. So this is, you know, let's say 1, this is 2, and the only unknowns in these two equations are FF and alpha, right? So we can solve for both of them. So if you solve for FF and alpha by substituting for all the numbers that are given to you, then you will find that FF is equal to 503.4 pounds. This is what is determined. So the second part of the question says, after you determine the normal and friction forces, the minimum coefficient of the static friction required for the wheel to roll without the slip. So FF, in that case, the magnitude of this would be equal to mu s times n. So we already know what n is, so mu s is FF over norm of n. And that turns out to be 0.6840. So that's your static coefficient of friction. Now, if you want to find out the time it takes for the car to reach 60 miles per hour, that can be done too, because we know the alpha, so we know AgX, which is R times alpha. So we know the A, the acceleration along horizontal direction. We know the initial velocity is given as 0 and final is 60 miles per hour. So we can use the constant acceleration formula, which is one of the Galileo's equation, to find out the time, right? So V final is equal to V0 plus AgX times delta T. VF is known, V0 is known, AgX is determined, and that allows us to compute the delta T, the time elapsed in going from 0 to 60 miles. Now, this problem could be actually framed in so many different ways. So in this case, you were given the supply side. So you need the torque from the engine, you need the load from the frame of the car on the rear wheel, and you had to find the friction forces, you had to find the normal reaction, you also had to find the acceleration of the car, okay? I could turn this problem in the opposite way, and I could say that I want to determine what should be the size of my engine for a given kinematic performance. So I want my car to go from 0 to 60 miles per hour in 3 seconds. So that means that I actually give you the acceleration. So you won't have to determine this AG. AG would be completely known to you. Okay, so because the linear acceleration of the entire car would be same. So you know the AG, and then from this relationship, you will also be able to get the angle acceleration of the wheels. So actually AG and alpha would be entirely known to you. Okay, so you know that part. Then you would create the free body diagram that you see over here, and you would have to determine some of the unknowns. So let's see how many unknowns we would have in that case. So if the kinematic performance is given, then let's say you don't know what H is, you don't know what V is, you don't know what the moment should be, you also don't know what FF is, and you don't know what N is. So it looks like you have 5 unknowns in that case to determine, right? But this analysis, kinetic analysis using Newton-Euler equation, will only give you 3 scalar equations. From 3 scalar equations, you can solve for only 3 unknowns. So somehow we have to get rid of the 2 unknowns from this problem in that case, right? So it turns out that we can get rid of FF and N from that analysis by looking at the car as an entire system, okay? So if you look at the car as an entire system, and I'm going to draw this roadster again, at least I will try to, okay? So if you look at the entire car has a center of mass, let's call it GC, as the center of mass of the car, differentiated from the center of mass of the wheel. And we would know something about, you know, how far the center of mass of these wheels are. Let's say this is A, this is B, okay? And maybe we also know what these distances are from the center of mass. So let's say this is C and this is D, okay? So all these geometric parameters are known to us as to where the center of mass of the wheels are located with respect to the center of mass of the car. All right. And what we know is the acceleration of the GC. So we know A is equal to A sum GC times I hat. All right. That's our kinematic performance. And that will be the linear acceleration of the center of mass of the wheels as well, right? Because the car is a complete body. It's not like that the center of mass of the wheel will have a different linear acceleration from the linear acceleration of this point, right? So acceleration of the center of mass of the wheel is also AGC, which means AGC is equal to R times its angular acceleration. And for simplicity, let's assume that the two wheels in the front and the back are of identical sizes. So AGC is equal to R alpha. Since AGC is given, you can determine the alpha from that, right? And that means that the kinematic analysis is fairly simple in this case, because we know the kinematic performance, we know the angular velocity, and we know the angular acceleration. Now, looking at the car as the system, if you draw a free body diagram, you will have the weight of the car, you will have the normal reaction. Let's say this point is A, this point is B, you'll have the normal reaction NA, you'll have the normal reaction NB that way, and then you have the friction force, let's say FA, on the rear wheels. There's no friction force on the front wheel because this is a rear wheel drive, right? So when you apply your torque on the rear wheels, the friction forces can be only on the rear wheels. So on the front wheels, there's no external torque applied, so there cannot be any friction force acting on it. If this was an all-wheel drive car, then there will be friction forces on all the four wheels, okay? Now, we can determine FA and A and NB by applying Newton-Euler equation. So if you do sigma F equal to MA, which is MA of GC, then the only friction, only force in the horizontal direction is FA, so that's FA I hat plus NA plus NB minus weight of the car along J hat direction equal to M times, and acceleration is AGC I hat. Okay, so we know AGC. So FA is equal to M times AGC. Since AGC is known, M is known, that gives us the friction force on the rear wheel. Okay, now, of course, because this is actually going to be a four-wheel car, so we'll have actually two FA over here. We'll have two NA and two NB, right, in that direction. So that means that the FA would be really this divided by two, okay? So friction force is known. Now, from the J-hat direction equation, we get two NA plus two NB minus MG equal to zero, and that means we have to determine NA and NB, which can also be done, because for the car, we can write sigma MGC equal to IGC times alpha. Since the car is, as a complete body, only translating, it has no angular acceleration. So we can take the moment about GC and equate it to zero. So that would be equal to FA times D. FA times D, and that will be positive, minus NA times A, plus NB times B equal to zero. FA is known and NA and NB are unknown, but now you have two equations in NA and B. We can determine both normal reaction A as well as normal reaction B. So you can analyze the whole car as a system and apply the Newton-Euler equation to that, and that would give you the friction forces as well as normal reaction on the rear wheel, okay? So once you have that, you can substitute that in here, and now FF and N, which are FA and NA respectively, are known to you. So the only three unknowns now are V, M0, and H. So in this problem, example problem 7.9, these three quantities are given, but now these three quantities have become unknown. No big deal. we have the requisite equations to solve for those unknowns. Everything in these equations over here is known except for H, V, and MO. Right? Where is MO? Right here. So MO. So those three unknowns can be determined as well. So this particular problem can be framed in so many different ways. Another question I may have for you is, okay, I give you this problem. This is the kinematic performance I'm looking for. You know, you compute the moment, you compute the friction forces, but I also want to know if you can really get that performance from this car. So you can apply the torque needed. You can have that kinematic performance, theoretically speaking, but if the friction force exceeds the maximum possible friction force available, then the car is going to skid, right? So if you find that friction force that you compute over here, FA, is actually more than mu s times Na, right? Let's say you compute the Na and you compute friction force and compare it with mu s Na, and if this is the case, then you know that the car is going to skid, right? The car is actually going to slip, and if the car slips, then all bets are off. You cannot use this relationship right over here, right? Because this relationship is only valid if the car actually rolls without slipping. If the car rolls with slip, or if it slips entirely, then this relationship is not valid, right? Because this is obtained from no slip condition. So what do you do in that case? So if it turns out that friction force is more than mu s Na, then you know that the friction force A would be actually equal to mu k times Na, right? It is going to be mu k times Na, and the direction of this friction force would change as a result. So the car is slipping in the forward direction and towards the right, then this friction force is going to be pointing towards left, because the whole car is actually slipping forward, and the job of the kinetic friction force is to oppose that motion. So in that case, the friction force would be known to you, right? So you actually lose on having this relationship, but you gain on knowing the nature of the friction force completely, right? So then these are the variables that you would use in the problem. So this by itself makes for a very interesting set of problems. It's not just one problem, but you know, quite a few problems. And in your chapter, you'll find a few examples of those, as well as in some of the unsolved problems that you'll have an opportunity to solve as homework problems.